إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام الله، خير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وبعد، we'll continue today إن شاء الله talking about the great صحابي أبو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه. And we reached in the last week when أبو بكر رضي الله عنه became خليفة. So tonight, inshallah, we'll try to talk about some of the important things that Abu Khalifa, Abu Bakr radiallahu anh dealt with after he became the Khalifa. The first thing I'd like to concentrate on the khutbah of Abu Bakr after he became Khalifa. He said, أما بعد أيها الناس فإني قد وليت عليكم ولست بخيركم، فإن أحسنت فأعينوني وإن أسأت فقوموني، الصدق أمانة والكذب خيانة، والضعيف فيكم قوي عندي حتى أرجع عليه حقه إن شاء الله، والقوي فيكم ضعيف عندي حتى أخذ الحق منه إن شاء الله. لا يدع قوم للجهاد في سبيل الله إلا خذلهم الله بالذل، ولا تشيع الفاحشة في قوم إلا عمهم الله بالبلاء. أطيعوني ما أطعت الله ورسوله، فإذا عصيت الله ورسوله فلا طاعة لي عليكم، قوموا إلى صلاتكم يرحمكم الله. So he said to proceed, O people, I became your Khalifa, your governor, and I'm not the best amongst you. If I do good, help me. If I do bad, then correct me. Subhanallah. This is the Khalifa. This is the one who learned in the school of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. He is not considering himself that because he became Khalifa now, because he is Amir, that this means that what he is saying is absolutely true. He's not saying like Fir'aun, لا أريكم إلا ما أرى ولا أهديكم إلا سبيل الرشاد. So what I see, you must see, and I am only guiding you to the right way, in his opinion. And actually he was calling them for destruction. So this is the manhaj, the way that Abu Bakr laid down for the Ummah, for anyone who's in charge, that if I am doing right, help me so I can continue. If I do something wrong, then correct me. This means that I will not continue doing what I am doing. Then he said that the truth is amana. The truth, telling the truth, is honesty. Because when you tell someone some news, for example, and that person, he believes that what you are saying is the truth, and you are actually telling something wrong or false or lies, actually you are betraying that person, because he is what? He is putting his trust in you. He believes that what you are saying is true. So sidq aman. So when you tell the people the truth, you are paying the amana in the right way. والكذب خيانة and lying is betraying. Then he said that there might be people who are weak and maybe some people took their rights. So he said, if there is someone weak, he cannot get his rights easily. So this person will be strong with my support until I take his right from the one who took it. And the one who thinks that he is strong, actually is very weak with me until I take the right from him. This is the adil, this is the justice. That don't think because you have supporters or you have maybe big muscles and big build that you can take what you like. No. Abu Bakr saying, doesn't matter what you are, if you are taking the people's rights, you are weak. You worth nothing. Until I take the right from you. Then after that, it's up to you. And don't think that if you became vulnerable and the people they are taking your life, that no one will support you. No, no, no. The government, the Khalifa now, is for you, for those people who are weak, those who've been oppressed. So in this way, when the Imam, with the Khalifa, with the Amir saying that, in those who are thinking that they can do what they like, they will start to think, oh, there is Khalifa, he will apply justice. And then he spoke about the importance of the jihad. Jihad in the right understanding. When you defend the ummah, when you protect the properties of the ummah, the properties of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said that when the people, they just ignore the jihad, they just live this life without thinking about sacrificing for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah will humiliate him. And this great Sahabi said, this great man said, is absolutely true. Look at the history of this ummah. When they were strong, and when the jihad was there again in its true meaning, then everyone was scared from them. No one will occupy their land. No one will treat their people in a bad way. No one will take their properties. But when the ummah, everyone started just thinking about money and start about this dunya, then we are in this humiliated situation. Then he spoke about something to do with social life and crime. He said, when the ummah reached a point that the fahisha, al-fahisha mainly mean the zina, the fornication, the adultery, when it became the norm in a society, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish them by a lot of trials. And this is what you can see in the Western societies these days. Because al-fahisha became numb now and no one is talking about it. Actually, you are not allowed in certain circumstances. You cannot say this wrong, because they consider this discrimination, or you are not practicing tolerance when you are saying these actions is haram, these actions is wrong. Then he end by saying, obey me as long as I obey Allah. If I disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then I have no right over you to obey me. What a great Khalifa. He's linking now the ta'a, the obedience for the ummah, for his followers, with how much he's obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he's saying clearly, if I reach a point that I am not obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you are free. You don't have to obey me. Because originally, you obey me because I am obeying Allah. Now, if I disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then why you obey me? Actually, you go back to what he said at the beginning. قَوِّمُونِ Correct me. This is what Al-Khalifa Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said in his first speech. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he will guide the ummah to remember what this great Sahabi said. After that, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu started to organize the country. So he chose Umar al-Khattab to be al-Qadi. And he chose Abu Ubaidah radiallahu anhu to be the treasurer. And Zayd ibn Thabit to be the writer, the one who liked the secretary. And other Sahaba, they have their rules. And then he chose the governors for the other places, for Mecca, for Yemen, Hadramaut, everyone of this. And he laid down how they will rule. And he said, Quran is Sunnah to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is how you act and how you deal with the people when there's a problem. After that, there was what they call it Jaysh Usama, the army of Usama. And I think I mentioned to you before that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before his death, he appointed Usama ibn Zayd radiallahu anhu to go to Syria because there was news at that time that these people trying to attack Muslims and should to show these people also that the Muslim ummah is a strong ummah and it's not easy to be attacked. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered Usama ibn Zayd to be the leader few days before his death sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that army, they were just outside the Medina, and among them, as I mentioned before, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, the great Sahaba Khalid, many of the Sahaba. Now when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, so the whole situation changed, and many of these people came back to Al-Medina. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he spoke to the Sahaba and he said, I have to send Usama ibn Zayd in his army. Now here, there was discussion. And the discussion based on two facts. The first fact, that the news came that many people, now they left Islam. Especially from these Bedouins around the Medina. And they might attack the Medina at any time. So they need a strong army to be there to defeat these people. The second point, that among those people in the army, they were the great Sahaba. And this new Khalifa now needs help and advice. So if all of them they leave Medina, then who will consult them? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he spoke to them and he reminded them about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept from the deeds except what you do this for only his sake. Make all the time or seek all the time Allah for your deeds. And he reminded them of those who passed away. And think about those who came before you. And he reminded them about that the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he died, his order was to send Jaish Usama, the army of Usama. And he said, I cannot untie a flag or a banner that the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam tied himself. Means that the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam ordered this army to be ready. I cannot say to this army, no, there is no need for you anymore. When Abu Bakr said that, some of the Sahaba radhiyallahu anhum started to talk about the subject and saying, no, we don't want this to happen. And as I said to you, they have their reasons. Usama radiallahu anhu sent Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu to Abu Bakr. And he said to him, talk to Abu Bakr to give us permission just to go back and stop this mission. Umar radiallahu anhu came, spoke to Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr refused totally. Then in the next day, Abu Bakr called for a general meeting. And he asked the people their opinion, and they spoke their opinion. So when the meeting finished, he said, I listen to you, and we'll meet tomorrow to decide about this. Then the second day, they have another meeting. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he said to them, forget the idea of canceling this mission. And he said, I will send Usama. And he said these words, وَالَّذِي نَفْسُ أَبِي بَكْرٍ بِيَدِهِ لَوْ ظَلَمْتُ أن السباعة تخطفني لأنفذت بعث أسامة كما أمر به رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ولو لم يبق في القرى غيري لأنفذت. He said, by the one who is the soul of Abu Bakr in his hand, if the beasts, the wild animals, will take me, I will send the army of Usama as the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم ordered, even if I am the only one who lived in Medina. So you can see how persistent Abu Bakr was in this matter. And subhanAllah, yani the opinion of Abu Bakr was the right opinion. Because later we'll see that sending that army was a great benefit to Islam and Muslims. Then one of the Ansar, he said, okay, if this is your decision, let someone else to lead the army. Because Usama is still young. And Umar, he said, you know, I think he's right. At that minute, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu grabbed Umar by his beard. And he said to him, ثكلتك أمك يا ابن الخطاب استعمله رسول الله وتأمرني أن أنزع. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said to him, may your mother lose you, ابن الخطاب. The Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم appointed him and he want me to move him from his position. Who am I to do this? Allah Akbar. When Umar left the meeting and the people, they said to him, what's wrong with you? He said, yani, go and follow what Abu Bakr said because I had a bad day because of the mission you sent me. Look what happened to me. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu went to the army and Usama was riding and Abu Bakr was walking. Now who's walking now? The Khalifa. Who's riding? Usama, 18, 20 years old. And Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf, Sahab al-Jaleel, he was the one who's holding Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu camel. Usama said, Ya Khalifa Rasulullah, either you come down or I come down. Either I come down or you ride. Abu Bakr said, by Allah, you stay where you are and I keep walking. And he said, وَمَا عَلَيَّ أَنْ أُغَبِّرَ قَدَمَيَّ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ سَعَى. What's wrong in dusting my feet for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for an hour? Allah Akbar. And every time I read these words, brothers and sisters, I see what a great sahabi it was. مَا عَلَيَّ أَنْ أُغَبِّرَ قَدَمَيَّ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ سَعَى. It is a message to us. Sometimes when there is something for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we are reluctant. Shall I do it or not? Shall I go or not? Remember these words of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. مَا عَلَيَّ أَنْ أُغَبِّرَ قَدَمَيَّ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ سَعَى. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he liked to have the dust on his feet for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now these days, we don't have dust. We have cars, and we have trains, and we have planes. And despite all these facilities, we don't do it. Did look how humble Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. He said to Usama, Usama, you are the leader of the army. Can I ask you a favor? Khalifa asking the leader of the army. Said, you are the Khalifa. You order. He said, can I have Umar ibn Khattab? Because I might need him. Can I have him? Abu Bakr asking. Yeah, Abu Bakr, it was easy for him to say, Usama, look, you have 1,000 Sahabi, give me 20, 30 of them. Go with the rest. He said, can I have Umar Khattab? Because I might need him. And Usama, of course, he said, of course you can. Then Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he gave them the war rules, which is, as Muslims, I think every one of us should memorize these rules. And every one of us should teach his children these rules. To show the human being, to show the human beings how Islam organizes everything in the life. And even if it is war, this doesn't mean that we forget our values. Even if we are subject to be killed, we don't forget the justice. And as I mentioned many times in this place, we are not killers. We are people who try to apply justice. He said to them, لا تخونوا ولا تغلوا ولا تغدروا ولا تمثلوا ولا تقتلوا طفلا صغيرا ولا شيخا كبيرا ولا امرأة. Don't betray. Don't take anything from the booties before it has been divided. Don't break your promises. Don't do anything to the body if that body is killed, disfigured, or do anything to it. Don't kill a child or an old man or a woman. Then he said, ولا تعقروا نخلا ولا تحرقوه ولا تقطعوا شجرة مثمرة. Don't cut a palm tree or burn it, and don't cut any tree which produce fruits. ولا تذبحوا شاة ولا بقرة ولا بعيرا إلا بمكان. Don't kill a sheep or a cow or a camel unless you want to eat it, not for killing. وسوف تمرون بأقوام قد فرغوا أنفسهم في الصوامع فدعوهم وما فرغوا أنفسهم لا. And you will pass people that they dedicated themselves in these arches or the place of worship. Leave them for what they dedicated themselves for. وسوف تقدمون على قوم يأتونكم بآنية فيها ألوان الطعام فإذا أكلتم منه شيئا بعد شيء فاذكروا اسم الله عليه. And you came to people, they will bring to you different types of food. If you eat any of it, then mention Allah's name on it. وتلقون أقواما قد فحصوا أوساط رؤوسهم وتركوا حولها مثل العصائب فاخفقوهم بالسيف خفقا. And you'll find people, they are dedicated themselves for fighting you. These people, fight them and kill them. اندفعوا بسم الله. Go for the sake in the name of Allah. You can see here. Where is the human beings these days? And the human rights of this. Look. Don't kill children, women, old men, and every day you find. Even those who call themselves Muslims, they are doing the same, unfortunately. While I was coming, the news about in Kenya, they came to a bus, these what they call them Shabab in Somalia, and killed about 30 people. Just they came to a bus and killed the people. Is this the Islam that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came with? Abu Bakr came with? Come to Abbas and kill, because the people they are traveling, you kill them? Where is it? These people, yeah, when you see what they are doing, how they kill, this is nothing to do with Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam or this great Sahabi did. And you'll find this wasaya, these instructions was fulfilled. You read the history, even the history which is written by non-Muslims, you'll not find that they say in the time of the Sahaba that you'll find Muslims killing women or killing children or killing old people or killing the religious people like here. But these days, as I said, unfortunately, some Muslims, and when you talk about non-Muslims, they are doing anything because there is no rules at all. Then Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he told him even how to move. And when the news, this is what I said to you earlier, when the news came to Heracles, the Heracles, who was the leader of the Romans at that time, he said, what's wrong with these people? Just yesterday, their leader died, and now they are sending an army?